Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core exam. In this lab, we'll test out the three STP optional features covered in the previous lecture video: PortFast, BPDU Guard, and BPDU Filter. Let's take a look at the lab instructions. So we'll start with step one, which says to enable PortFast where appropriate, and then test that it's working. So where is appropriate here? Any switch port that doesn't connect to another switch. So, switch 1 G00, for example, which connects to R1. This is router on a stick, by the way. R1 routes between VLANs 1 and 2. And we should enable PortFast on switch 3 G02 and 3 also. I'll go on switch 1 first. First, I'll enable spanning tree event debugging with debug spanning tree events. Now, you've already seen the standard STP listening, learning, forwarding process many times before, so I won't demonstrate what it's like without PortFast. Let's just enable PortFast straight away. Conf T, interface G00, spanning tree PortFast. Let's check that it's configured. Do show running config, interface G00. Notice that the command was converted to spanning tree PortFast edge, as I covered in the lecture video. However, let's use another command to check if PortFast is actually active. Do show spanning tree interface G00 PortFast. This command says that PortFast is disabled. Why is that? It's because G00 is a trunk. To enable PortFast on a trunk, let's configure spanning tree PortFast trunk. Now let's check again. Do show spanning tree interface G00 PortFast. Okay, now it's enabled. So let's test PortFast by disabling and re-enabling the interface. Shut down. I'll wait a couple seconds for the log messages to appear, and now let's re-enable it. No shutdown. Thanks to PortFast, the port is able to immediately jump to the forwarding state. Now let's enable PortFast on switch 3 as well. I'll enable it on G02 and G03, which are both access ports. To do so, I'll enable PortFast on all access ports by default from global config mode. First, I'll enable STP event debugging with debug spanning tree events. And now, let's configure it. Conf T, spanning tree PortFast default. Let's check if it was enabled on both interfaces. Do show spanning tree interface G02 PortFast. Okay, G02 in VLAN 1 has PortFast enabled. And next, do show spanning tree interface G03 PortFast. And it's enabled on G03 also. Next, I'll test it on both interfaces. Interface range G02 to 3. Shutdown. Wait a couple seconds for the log messages to appear, and let's re-enable them. No shutdown. Thanks to PortFast, they immediately enter the forwarding state. Now, just to verify that PortFast-enabled ports still send BPDUs, I'll use do show spanning tree interface G02 detail. At the bottom, notice the BPDU's sent value. Now, a couple seconds later, I'll use the command again, and the value has increased. So, it's still sending BPDUs, even with PortFast enabled. Okay, that's enough about PortFast. Let's return to the lab guide for step 2, which says to enable BPDU Guard where appropriate and test that it is working. Then, we'll enable Air Disable Recovery for ports disabled by BPDU Guard. Now, before doing that, let's see what happens if PC1's user connects their own switch, this rogue switch, to switch 3 G02. Let me return to the CLI of switch 3. Now I'll delete the cable connecting PC1 to switch 3, and let's connect it to the rogue switch by right-clicking on switch 3 and adding the link. So what happens as a result of this? Look at the debug messages. Switch 3 says that the new root is on port G02. It's the rogue switch. It had a lower bridge ID than switch 1, so it became the new root, which affects the rest of the STP topology. This is not acceptable, so let's configure BPDU Guard to shut down G02 when it receives a BPDU from the rogue switch. Since I'm already in interface config mode for G02 and G03, I'll enable it here. Spanning Tree BPDU Guard Enable. Soon after enabling BPDU Guard, Switch 3 receives a BPDU from the rogue switch, and BPDU Guard disables G02. So, we've confirmed that BPDU Guard works. Let's check its status with Do Show Interfaces Status. Indeed, G02 is in the Air Disabled state. Now let's enable Air Disable Recovery. Exit. First, I'll confirm that it's not enabled. Do Show Air Disable Recovery. As you can see, Air Disable Recovery is disabled for all causes. Now, before enabling it for BPDU Guard, let me shorten the recovery interval so that it doesn't take as long. The default is 5 minutes. The command is air disable recovery interval, and let's check the options. The minimum is 30 seconds, so I'll set it to that. Now let's enable recovery for BPDU Guard. Air disable recovery cause BPDU Guard. And another important step is to disconnect the offending switch. So I'll do that now by right-clicking on the cable connecting switch 3 to the rogue switch and deleting it. Now let's check air disable recovery again. Do show air disable recovery. At the bottom of this output, it lists the interfaces that are currently air disabled and when they will be re-enabled. G02 will be re-enabled soon. If we didn't first disconnect the rogue switch though, it would immediately be re-disabled after coming online again. So always remember that step. If you don't remove the cause of the problem, air disable recovery is pointless. Although, note that I did have some problems with this in CML. When I tested it with Switch 3 and the rogue switch still connected, Switch 3 G02 wasn't disabled again after recovering. That seems to be a bug in CML, because I tested it on real hardware and it worked as expected. If you notice any strange behavior like that when doing these labs in CML, it's probably just a bug. Sometimes it's best to lab on real hardware if it's available. Now let's return to the lab guide for step 3. Step 3 says to disable BPDU Guard on switch 3 and enable BPDU Filter instead. We should test how it works when enabled globally and how it works when enabled directly on interfaces. So let's return to switch 3 and remove BPDU Guard first. We're just going to test BPDU Filter on G02, so I'll just remove BPDU Guard from that interface. Interface G02, no spanning tree, BPDU Guard enable. So first I'll test how BPDU Filter behaves when enabled globally. Exit. Let's enable it by default. Spanning tree PortFast. Now let me use the question mark here. Notice three options, Edge, Network, and Normal. There is no BPDU Filter option. If I type Edge, there will be a BPDU Filter option. However, even without typing Edge, let me just type BPDU Filter, and then use the question mark again. It says unrecognized command, but I'll type default at the end and hit enter. And the command works. Let's check the running config. Do show run pipe include BPDU filter. So the command was applied as spanning tree portfast edge BPDU filter default. However, even though Cisco has changed the command syntax to use the edge keyword, the old command without edge still works. It's the same for enabling portfast and BPDU guard too. You can include the edge keyword or leave it out. Now let's check if BPDU filter is actually enabled on G02. Do show spanning tree interface G02 detail. Now I want to point something out. CML doesn't know when ports are connected or not. For example, even though G02 is connected to nothing, it's a designated port in the forwarding state. On a real switch, this would be down, but not in CML. Just keep that in mind. Anyway, at the bottom of this output, it says BPDU filter is enabled by default. What if I connect the rogue switch to switch 3 G02? Let's do that. After connecting them, switch 3 once again accepts the rogue switch as the root bridge. What happened to BPDU filter? Let's check with do show spanning tree interface G02 detail again. It no longer states that BPDU filter is enabled. Now let's try enabling it directly on G02. Interface G02, spanning tree BPDU filter enable. Now it should stop sending BPDUs out of G02, and also start ignoring all BPDUs received from the rogue switch. Although spanning tree is technically still enabled on G02, configuring BPDU filter on it makes it like STP has been disabled on the port. After G02's max age timer expires, it once again accepts switch 1 as the root bridge, because it is ignoring the superior BPDUs from the rogue switch. Okay, now I'll disconnect the rogue switch and reconnect PC1 to switch 3 G02. Let's return to the lab guide for step 4. It says simply to use BPDU filter to cause a broadcast storm. This is obviously not recommended in a real network, but let's try it out. So the easiest way to do this is to enable it on the links between switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3. Let's go on switch 3, and I'll enable it on G00 and G01. Interface range G00 to 1, spanning tree BPDU filter enable. And next, switch 2. Conf-t, interface range G00 to 1, spanning tree BPDU filter enable. Okay, finally switch 1. Interface range G01 to 2, spanning tree BPDU filter enable. We'll have to wait a bit for the max age timers to count down, but then they should move their ports all to forwarding, causing a loop. Now, we don't have to manually generate any broadcast frames, because PC1 and PC2 both regularly send DHCP discover messages, which are broadcast. Those DHCP discover messages will loop around switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3 indefinitely. Now let's confirm that a broadcast storm is actually happening. I'll right-click on the link between switch 2 and switch 3, and do a packet capture. Click on Settings, and let's set the max packets to 500, and then click Apply. Now before I click Start, I want you to look at the bottom left here. I don't know if the text is clear in the video or not, but it says capture not running. After I click Start, you'll see the total number of packets captured increase. So I'll click on Start, and then before you know it, it says capture not running again. The 500 packet limit of the packet capture was reached basically immediately, and these are all DHCP discover messages. We can only see 10 packets per page, but I'll click here and increase the limit to 250. As you can see, these are all DHCP discover messages, looping around between switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3. So the lesson here is that you should be careful about using BPDU filter, especially when you enable it directly in interface config mode. Okay, in this lab, we experimented with PortFast, BPDU Guard, and BPDU Filter. That's all for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the Join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, George, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo Macedo, Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Dragos Hernea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Vitaus194, Chance Carter 56, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Fristas1207, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Maria Tuba, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Konivez, 5 Feet, Owad, Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Kevin Hayes, Samuel Tavarez, Roger Bratseth, Mustafa Ersoy, Nasser Zahar, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemejev, Hypocrisy Allergic, Arlen Plagaria, Dear Diso, Adelson Pereira, Farad69, Joyce Njoroge, Lucien Stoichitoyu, Madmark50484, Alexandru Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, DMJ2, Kurt Nell, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Wilmer Romero, Laurent Lam, Pedro Hartman, Ivano Capuano, Enigma G, Jefferson Steelflex, Alejandra Okana, Burl Campbell, Abhishek Sahu, Toxic, Sinan Sarisinar, Gio, Daniel Andrade, Jairo Francisco, Mike Crumby, Eliel Eliluli, Dragos George, Vijay Kumar Pili, Philip Jovanovich, Random User 7547, Wagner Botelho, ICT EDU Official, and Mateusz Wzaszynski. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching.